Good morning, church. Welcome. We should start doing that more often. That's nice. Well, let's stand and read our call to worship together. It's based on Psalm 27 and John 4. As usual, I will read the regular text and you read the bolded text aloud with me. Let us worship God, our light and our salvation. The Lord is the stronghold of our lives. We desire to live in God's house and to seek God in his holy temple. We have come with shouts of joy to sing and to make music to the Lord. Let us worship God in spirit and in truth. Teach us your ways and make straight our paths in this hour of worship and always.
Our God, a firm foundation, our rock, the only solid ground. Nations rise and fall. Kingdoms once strong, now shaken. We trust forever in your name, the name of Jesus. We trust the name of Jesus, you are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious. You are the only King forever. Almighty God, we lift you higher. You are the only King forever, forevermore. You are victorious.
Unmatched in your wisdom,
unmatched in all your wisdom, in love and justice you will reign, and every knee will bow. We bring our expectations, our hope is anchored in your name, the name of Jesus.
Almighty God, we lift you higher. Let's read this prayer from Psalms together. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. Rejoice in the Lord, O you righteous, and give thanks to God's holy name. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. God's greatness is unsearchable. Do you feel the world is broken?
We do.
Do you feel the shadows deepen?
We do.
Do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through?
We do.
Do you wish that you could see it all made new? Is all creation groaning? Is a new creation coming? Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst? Is it good that we remind ourselves of this?
It is.
Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of the Father truly love us?
He does.
Does the Spirit move among us?
He does.
And does Jesus, our Messiah, hold forever those he loves?
He does.
Does our God intend to dwell again? Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave. He is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. From every people and tribe, as a kingdom and priest to God to reign with the Son. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is he worthy of
he is.
Is he worthy? As we come into his presence together this morning, let's take a moment in corporate confession. And so would you read this prayer aloud with me? Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us amend what we are and direct what we shall be, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. And this morning I'm going to read for us from the Heidelberg Catechism. And we do this every so often. It's good to read. This is an important statement of faith in the EPC, and it's good for us to reaffirm what it is we believe. So question and answer, both 59 and 60 says, by true faith in Jesus Christ, I am right with God and heir to life everlasting. Even though my conscience accuses me of having grievously sinned against all God's commandments and of never having kept any of them. And even though I am still inclined toward all evil, nevertheless, without my deserving it at all, out of sheer grace, God grants and credits to me the perfect satisfaction, righteousness, and holiness of Christ. As if I had never sinned nor been a sinner, as if I had been perfectly obedient, as Christ was obedient for me. All I need to do to accept this gift of God with a believing heart.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Jesus, a name above every other name, Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes and wonder, show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
He's a name above every other name.
Jesus, a name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever see. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you, there is none beside you. Open up my eyes and fill me with your heart and lead me
one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me.
Amen. You may be seated.
Well, good morning, everybody. Thank you for joining this morning. It is, it's good to see familiar faces. It's good to see y'all. And for anyone viewing online, thank you for joining us. We're glad that you're watching online. We're thankful for the tech team and for Alex, who has done so much work for making it possible for y'all to watch online. We are Fountain City Church. We're a church, obviously, we're here in Johnson County, and we are all about people knowing God. And we're glad that God knows us, and we're glad that we know him. And if you don't know God, we're glad you're here. Couple things in life of our church this week. On Friday night, we're going to a Royals game. We've got 4 tickets that are still available. So if you do not have tickets and you're thinking, hey, I would love to go, let me know. You can reach out to me on Slack, or you can come by me after the service. Or if there is someone in your life that you've thought, hey, I would love for this person to come, they're a close friend of mine, or maybe they're people that you've thought about, well, I may want to invite them to come to church with us, but I'm not sure, I don't know how they feel about that kind of thing, or you want to have more spiritual conversations with them. One thing we believe in is that spiritual conversations happen when we are in having regular conversations and living regular life with people. So invite them to the game, and we'd love for them to take up some of those tickets. We're going to have to figure out carpooling, so be looking for correspondence from me, because we have 6 parking passes and 30 people going. So we need to figure out who's going with who and how we're going to do that. So really looking forward to that. You'll notice that Doug is preaching today, and I just wanted to call out James and Lindsay. Thank you for all the good work that you do, and I hope this week has been restful for y'all. And if y'all have an opportunity or want to take time this week, say a prayer for James and Lindsay and their family as they're just taking a little bit of time away, and they'll be back this week. Which is a not-so-subtle segue. They will be back for us to invade their house on Wednesday night for home group. So we gather at 5:30 at the Cotter's house for home group. We have food. Please bring a side dish to share. It's really fun. If you haven't been there, it is just an absolute delight. So come, bring a side. They'll have food there, and we'll talk about Scripture, and we'll learn from each other. And then another thing is every Wednesday morning at 6 o'clock, we have morning prayer. So that's something that I lead, and then on Thursdays at noon, Doug leads a noontime prayer. And the reason that we do these things is severalfold, but one, we believe that praying is important, and so we don't want just prayer to be something that we talk about and that there's a little sermon about, or we talk about the Psalms, but we want that to be a regular part of our rhythm individually and together. And because we are the body of Christ, and so to see each other not just on Sunday mornings and occasionally on Wednesday evenings, but to see each other even over Zoom in the morning and in the afternoon is a lovely thing. And just speaking personally, I find myself very thankful for prayer and home group. A couple home groups ago, we were processing something, and Emma shared some experience that she's had about something, and it was like, oh my gosh, that was so helpful for me, because when we're hearing James or Doug preach on Sunday morning, it's great to hear their instruction and their teaching, but it's great to hear how each other are experiencing it. And then last home group, we were processing, I think we were talking about suffering, especially as we were talking about the psalm, that every good gift comes from God, and we were talking about that, and then Amy shared something. She said, you know, when I was in Hungary, I remember this person saying this about the Scriptures, and I thought, that just really stuck with me, the things that she shared, and I'm not going to, in the middle of the week be like, oh, I'm reading through a psalm, I wonder what Amy thinks about this, and I'm going to, send Amy a text, hey, Amy, do you have any quick help for me, or hey, Emma, what experience do you have in regards to this? But that's what's great about home group, is that we are all around each other and we're learning from each other. And so it's just really lovely. And if you have never been to home group, I encourage you to give it a shot this week. And for prayer, it is lovely praying through the Scriptures together and hearing from each other, being instructed from each other as we hear how each other pray, hearing from God as he speaks to us through each other's prayer and through his word. So if you have not been to home group or prayer, one of those two things, then I encourage you to join this week, to try and choose one of those things to try for the first time. And if you've never been to a Royals game, then you definitely need to do that too. Any other announcements that I'm missing? No? All right. Well, then, in a continuation with our series in the Psalms, I would invite you, if you're able, to stand with me as I read aloud Psalm 51. And this is on pages 11 and 12 in your bulletin. I'm going to read this, and then we'll have the call and response at the end. Psalm 51. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your great compassion, blot out my transgressions. Wash away all my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. For I know my transgressions, and my sin is always before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight. So you are right in your verdict and justified when you judge. Surely I was sinful at birth, sinful from the time my mother conceived me. Yet you desired faithfulness, even in the womb. You taught me wisdom in that secret place. Cleanse me with hyssop, and I will be clean. Wash me, and I will be whiter than snow. Let me hear joy and gladness. Let the bones you have crushed rejoice. Hide your face from my sins and blot out all my iniquity. Create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me from your presence or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. Then I will teach transgressors your ways so that sinners will turn back to you. Deliver me from the guilt of bloodshed, O God, you who are God, my Savior, and my tongue will sing of your righteousness. Open my lips, Lord, and my mouth will declare your praise. You do not delight in sacrifice, or I would bring it. You do not take pleasure in burnt offerings. My sacrifice, O God, is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart you, God, will not despise. May it please you to prosper Zion, to build up the walls of Jerusalem. Then you will delight in the sacrifices of the righteous, in burnt offerings offered whole. Then bulls will be offered on your altar. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may be seated.
All right, thank you, Justin. It's good to see everybody this morning. And yeah, we're hoping that I think James and Lindsay are coming back soon. So we'll look forward to seeing them and hearing how their time went. So before we jump into Psalm 51 today, I wanted to ask the kids something. I just want to address the kids. Now, you guys are so far back there, I'm not even sure if you can see me. Can you see me? There we go. Okay, kids, how many times have you, been running on the sidewalk, and you've tripped, and you fell, or maybe you're riding your bike, and you fell, and you scraped your knee? Has that ever happened to you? Yeah, has your knee ever gotten scraped where it's a little bit kind of owie? Yeah? Okay, what do mom and dad do when you show them what happened? What do they usually do? Do they kiss it? Sometimes, yeah, they kiss it, or sometimes do they clean it out? They put soap and water on it. Yep. And sometimes when they do that, when I was a kid, my mom put this red liquid on it that stings like crazy, right? And it's supposed to, and it was called Mercuricum or something. I don't even know exactly, but it was like, this is nasty. But she assured me that it was she needed to do that so that the wound would be clean. Because if the wound or the scrape isn't clean, then it won't heal properly, right? And so even though it stings a little bit when we put soap and water on it, we clean out that wound, in order for us to be healthy in the long run, we have to clean it out. Now today, what we're talking about is something a little more about our soul and our spirit. Because the same thing is true in our spirit. If we want to be right with God, if we want to be healthy in our relationship with God, we have to clean out sometimes our sin, and sometimes that hurts and it stings a little bit to admit it. And so that's kind of what we're talking about today. And so you're going to hear, kids, if you want to keep track, you're going to hear, I'm not sure what words I'm going to say the most, but you're going to hear me say forgiveness and confession and repentance probably a lot. So just listen for those things. And so with that, let me pray for us, and we will jump into into the Word. Father, thank you for this morning. And God, we thank you for the worship that we are able to participate in. Thank you for Alex and the team that are just so willingly and just with great talent and expertly, they led us to the throne room where we could worship you and glorify you. Thank you for the community that we can gather together and encourage one another and to hear your word and to be reminded of your grace, where we confess corporately our sins to you, recognizing that we don't always live the way you call us to, but Lord, that you are full of grace and that you love us and that you forgive us and that you've done everything to cleanse us from our sin. So Lord, I pray this morning as we open your word from Psalm 51, that your Spirit would be at work in our lives, showing us how we can walk with you in a better way, showing us and convicting us of any sin that might be lingering. And so, Lord, we pray that you'd give us ears to hear today, that you'd give us eyes to see, that you'd give us hearts that would understand the things that you want to teach us. And so we lift these things up to you in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so every generation has its spiritual giants, right? Men and women who've shaped Christian thought and culture and doctrine. People who've defended the faith, who powerfully have taught God's word. They've taken the gospel to the ends of the world. People who've given their lives, they've sacrificed their lives to serve others. They've led millions, people who've led and influenced thousands and millions of people to come to know faith in Jesus. Names like Jonathan Edwards, John Calvin, Charles Spurgeon, Billy Graham, Mother Teresa, Dr. Martin Luther King. These are all people who have influenced our culture. And the list could go on and on, right? One of the giants of this generation, of our generation, was a man who passed away in 2020, Ravi Zacharias. Ravi was one of the most respected Christian apologists. He defended the faith like no other. He was an author of tons of books and shaped the minds of this past generation. He passed away after a long battle with cancer, and when he did, the world, and especially the church, grieved and mourned for him. That's why it came as such a shock when the reports after his death came out that of his misconduct and the abuse that he inflicted upon others around him. How could someone so influential fall so greatly into sin? And as the accusations against him were confirmed by many witnesses, we move from disbelief to disappointment to disgust, to the point now where many references to Ravi and his name and his ministry have been erased from the books. People are taking books off his shelves, his books off their shelves, and they're trying to, and he's being erased because of the great sin that he was involved in. And listen, he's not the only one who's fallen. Jerry Falwell Jr. These are some names. Jerry Falwell Jr., Carl Lentz from Hillsong, Mark Driscoll, Bill Hybels, all men who've had great influence and yet have struggled. They've fallen. They've sinned. They've abused their positions. But they've written books. They've produced music. They've led large institutions that have influenced thousands of people. And then one by one, we see their names smeared because of their sin. Their sin was uncovered. And like a rug that's pulled out from under them, all the influence and respect that they had gathered disappears. So what makes news about these guys and Ravi so shocking is that, especially with Ravi, that he went to his deathbed never having brought his sin out into the open, never having admitted it, never that we, as far as we know, repenting of his sin. You know, so for people who have high influence, who have a position of spiritual influence, the problem is they begin to believe their own accolades. They stop acknowledging that all they have is from God. Instead of showing humility, they grow prideful. Instead of being content with what God has given them, they begin to crave more. Many of these leaders have enjoyed their position of influence, but they've also struggled with crippling and private sin. And their sin may have started with just a small compromise. But if it's ignored, it can grow to the point where, when it's discovered, their position and influence in ministry is stripped from them. And the sad reality is that they'd rather cover it up than lose faith or lose face by admitting any wrongdoing. And seemingly none of them had people in their lives who were willing to call them to the carpet, who were willing to confront them in their wrongdoing. And so what we see is that eventually unconfessed sin catches up with them. It catches up with us. And when it does, the consequences can be devastating. And so these stories like Ravi Zacharias and some of these others, they serve as a bit of a warning to us concerning the sin in our own lives. We might not have the same level of influence, but we all struggle with the same thing. We read it in the Heidelberg Catechism today. We all have sin rooted in our heart, and we'll struggle with it. And sometimes we'd rather not let people know that we struggle so much. You know, the thing is, so even if our sin isn't big, if left unchecked, it'll grow. And when it grows, it sometimes can feel out of control. And what's so difficult is that once that sin train begins to gain speed, it's hard to stop and turn around. So we just keep on going in hopes that it won't be discovered. So here's the reality. See, here's kind of a reality for us. That unconfessed sin greatly damages our relationship with God. And eventually, it will leave a path of destruction in our life if we continue to let it grow. And so our main idea, if you're a note taker, here's the main idea for this morning. And it's good news. That God, who is rich in mercy and steadfast love, longs to forgive us and restore us when we repent of our sin. So in this passage in Psalm 51, David's going to model this idea of repentance and confession beautifully. Now, so our first point is this. It's just understanding the progression of sin. And so the subheading of the psalm gives us some context of why this was written. When it says, to the choir master, a psalm of David, when Nathan the prophet went to him and after he had gone into Bathsheba. Traditionally, we see this as a prayer of confession of David that he wrote when he was confronted with his own personal sin. But it's also used as a corporate psalm of confession for the nation of Israel to confess their sins. And we use it oftentimes. I mean, we will use it as a church as well. Now, the story that this introduction to the psalm is referring to is chronicled in 2 Samuel 11 and 12. It's at the height of David's reign as king of Israel. And so let's give a short history lesson here. We remember that Saul was the first king of Israel, but due to his own disobedience, God removed his blessing over Saul and promised that he would replace Saul as king with a man after God's own heart. So after David was anointed to be king by the prophet Samuel at a young age, even before he took the throne, we begin to see why God chose David as a king. In one of the most well-known stories about David, we remember he slayed the giant Goliath. That's one of some of our kids' favorite Bible stories. I remember that from last week. I watched James's sermon last week, and somebody's favorite Bible story is David and Goliath. I don't know who. And David didn't win because of his great strength, but he won because of his great faith in the Lord. And so as the victories piled up for young David in battle, Saul's jealousy of David grew. And even though Saul retained the crown, he knew that God had chosen David to be king. So Saul tried to kill David several times, and much of David's early life was on the run as King Saul pursued him. Eventually, Saul was killed in battle as a consequence of his own sin, and soon afterwards, David was anointed as the first king, over king of Israel. And for a while, David's leadership was united Israel, and God blessed David and the nation with victories and war and success in everything he did. And it's at the height of his reign as king that David gets comfortable, and he gets in trouble, and he gets lazy. In 1 Samuel 11, we read, in the spring of the year, the time when kings go out to battle, David sent Joab and his servants with him and all Israel. And they ravaged the Ammonites and besieged Rabbath. But David remained at Jerusalem. It happened one late afternoon when David rose from his couch and was walking on the roof of the king's house that he saw from the roof a woman bathing, and the woman was very beautiful. And from there, David's decision-making gets worse. He inquires about this woman and learns that she's the wife of one of the soldiers that's out in battle, one of his mighty men. And ignoring that red flag that's going off, he proceeds to bring her to his own palace where he sleeps with her, and then he sends her home. When Bathsheba informs David that she is pregnant, David tries to cover up his sin by bringing Uriah, her husband, back from the front lines in hopes that he would sleep with his wife and assuming that he then would take credit for his wife being pregnant. But because of his own integrity, Uriah refuses to sleep in his own bed while his troops are sleeping on the battlefront. At this point, David sees no other option but to order Uriah to the front lines of battle where he's likely to be killed. And that's exactly what happens. And when Uriah dies, David takes Bathsheba to be his wife. Let's pause here. Now, it's easy for us, as we hear the story, to see the progression of sin that started with neglecting his kingly responsibilities to lead his troops in battle. But he chose rather to remain in comfort in his own palace. And from there, we see that it starts with a glance that led to an abuse of power, resulting in adultery and cover-up, and eventually a conspiracy to commit murder. So it's easy to understand that why this thing that David had done had displeased the Lord. So it seems like the enemy likes to attack us along the lines of pride and sexual sin. And though any sin can derail us, in our culture especially, it's sexual sin that puts us on that slippery slope. And we don't have to, I'm not going to go into all the details of all the ways that can happen, but we know it to be true. We see it around us. We're tempted every day in those things. That's why the author of Proverbs wrote about so much about the allure of sexual temptation, warning the reader that indulging in sexual sin outside of God's design will lead to death. But here's the thing, for some reason, David doesn't see it. David doesn't care, either that or he doesn't care about what he's done. I don't know how, but David somehow is blind to his sin. Perhaps he was full of pride over his accomplishments, and he began to believe the praises of all the people and all the victories in battle and the songs that people would chant. Saul has killed his thousands, David his tens of thousands. I don't know. Maybe he thought after years of on the run for his own life that he deserved whatever he could get. Or maybe the comfort in the palace dulled him to what God was wanting in his life and in his position. But at this point, enter Nathan the prophet, a prophet from the Lord who shares a parable with David designed to illustrate the depravity of David's choices. Now, when David responds in anger over the inequity of the victim in the story shared with him, Nathan tells him, "Listen, David, you are that bad guy. That's you," in the parable that he told. And Nathan proceeds to tell David that because of this unjust violence that he has caused, that the sword will never depart from his mouth or his house. God will raise up evil against David within his own house, and that the baby that was to be born to Bathsheba would not survive. So all those consequences Nathan lays out before David. But to this rebuke by a friend, David acknowledges his sin against the Lord. And so that's what leads us to Psalm 51. And I know that's a long, it feels like a long introduction, but that was our first point. And so we're going to dive into the Word now. But before we do, let me say this one point. And here's kind of a principle, because I want to give a principle to each of these sections. And the first one is this. We need to have people in our lives who will not be afraid to call us out when we're blind to our own sin. We need people who will speak the truth to us, who will rebuke us, confront us, kick us in the rear, out of love, when we're acting out in a way that it's offensive to God. That's why the community, home group, coming to home group and being involved in a community and church or discipleship is so important, so where you're going to have encouragement to walk with God, where you're going to be held accountable to walk with God, where you're going to be, we're going to spur one another on to love and good deeds. You know, following Jesus takes humility. It takes humility to receive the rebuke when it happens. That's why God calls us and tells us that God opposes the proud, but He gives grace to the humble. So God gives us different ways to convict us. He gives us His Holy Spirit to convict us of sin, or people around us convict us of sin. However that happens, however God convicts us of sin, it's important for us to respond when we do. So as we go to our second point, we're going to see in the first part of Psalm 51, David's prayer of repentance, and he's really praying for repentance here in the first 9 verses. The whole psalm is a prayer to God, and we see David crying out to the Lord in repentance, and the first half focuses more on that, and the second half deals more with kind of being restored to right relationship with Him, and we'll get to that in a moment. But he cries out, he starts out crying out to God for mercy. David knows that he's guilty before God, and that what he's done is an abomination against the Lord. He has no room to stand. He knows it. He doesn't make excuses. He doesn't try to justify it. All he can do is cry out to God for mercy, knowing that it's not anything that he deserves. David pleads for mercy, not because of his own track record or because this is his first offense or anything like that, but he cries out to mercy based and according to God's own character. David knows that God is full of steadfast love and mercy, and his prayers that God's mercy will outweigh the justice in that situation, and God will blot out those transgressions from his ledger. David completely understands before he will be able to stand before God, he needs to be thoroughly cleansed from all his sin. In verse 3, David acknowledges that his sin is primarily against God. He certainly knows that his sin has ripple effects in the lives of the people around him. It certainly affected those involved in his story, Bathsheba, Uriah, the baby. But it also affected those others, that the ripple effects of David's family, of Bathsheba's family, Uriah's family. His sin caused great harm. And even the nation of Israel felt the consequences of his sin for generations to come. And so that's what makes David's confession in verse 3 all the more striking, because David knows what he did, but he sees his sin as primarily a sin against God, and who is righteous and holy. He knows that God is a standard of holiness and justice, and that what he did was pure evil in God's sight. And he also knows that he stands before God, and God would be completely blameless if he held his sin against him. See, first of all, David acknowledges his sin, and confession and repentance always involves acknowledgement of our sin. We can't truly repent if we don't fully acknowledge our sin before the Lord. It can't just go through the motions of saying words unless we bring it out to the open to God. It's easy to see the lack of sincerity in others when they give a half-hearted apology. That's really more of a justification for reasoning for why they stumbled. In order for forgiveness to be realized and for it to really cleanse us, we have to come clean about our sin. So let me pause for something right now just to clarify something you might be thinking, because because David says, against you and you only have I sinned, we might be thinking, well, you know, he did kind of sin against others, and he absolutely did. The psalm doesn't mention the reconciliation that needs to happen when our sin affects other people. So for our relationships to be restored, we must also apologize and seek forgiveness from people that our sin has affected. But before that happens, we have to get right with the Lord, and that's what this psalm is doing. And as horrendous as David's sin is, he knows what's important, that his most important relationship is with God. And that if he's right with God, that will affect his other relationships, even though the challenges or the consequences may not go away. In verse 5, David recognizes that his sin is not just seen in his behavior, but its roots are buried deep in his heart. He understands it's not just his sin with Bathsheba that condemns him, but that sin is woven into his inner being. From birth, even conception. See, there's no hiding our sin from God. God knows everything about it. So confession is more for our benefit, is bringing it out and bringing it and acknowledging it to the Lord. And David understands that there's nothing that he can do to make himself right in God's eyes. His sin separates him from God. His only hope is that God will purge him and make him clean. He understands that only God can erase him and blot out the sin. In verse 7, he uses the word hyssop. He said, he asked God to purge him with hyssop, to cleanse him. Hyssop was a plant that was used to sprinkle water for ceremonial cleansings. Like for leprosy, it'd be used to sprinkle water on a leper, for example. And so what David is asking is for God to cleanse his heart and his sin from inside, much like a leper would desire to be cleansed ceremonially. And the guilt, you can see the guilt that it's taken on David in verse 8. You can hear that when he desperately asks to feel joy again after God has broken and crushed his bones for the sin. The only hope that David has is that God will hide his face from David's sin and then blot out all of his iniquities. And here's the principle for this point. That sinful behaviors are born from a sinful heart. And so forgiveness cannot be achieved by our behavior, but only from God changing our heart from the inside out through his grace and mercy. Life and joy is abundant when our relationship with God is right, and even when the circumstances are less than ideal. When we're right with God, we can live through a lot of external circumstances, even when those circumstances are difficult. But life can be perfect on the outside, and if we're feeling the guilt of unconfessed sin, life is miserable from that. The good news of the gospel is that forgiveness is something that God is eager to provide for us. Through the work of Christ on the cross, God, in essence, has blotted out our iniquities. In Colossians 2, Paul says, God made you alive together with him, having forgiven us all of our trespasses by canceling the record of debt that's held against us with its legal demands that he set aside. And he's nailed it to the cross. So he's taken this list of sins, everything that we've ever done in our life, and he's nailed that to the cross and in essence said, all that debt is canceled. I'm blotting it out. So life and joy is abundant when our relationship with God is right. You know, and though even as we see in the psalm, David pleading for forgiveness, as believers, as followers of Christ, we can have confidence that we are already forgiven. 1 John 1:9 says, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And that's because the work of blotting out of the payment for our sin has already been made through Jesus. So in the first half of this psalm, David's praying for forgiveness. In the second half, David yearns for his relationship to be restored. And so our third point is this. It's just that it's a prayer for restoration. And so in my Bible, I have the verses 10 through 12 circled because it's such a beautiful prayer of restoration. It really clearly expresses the desire of a person who wants to be restored in his walk with God. And it reminds me that sin is always a hard issue. And so restoration must come from the inside out. You know, Paul Tripp, who's a pastor and an author in a devotional that I love called New Morning Mercies, he says this. He says, sin is always a matter of thoughts, desires, and motives and choices of the heart. Sin is a matter of the heart that expresses itself in the behavior of the body. Your body physically goes where your heart has already gone. And David understands that to be restored to this position of health and his relationship with God, that his heart needs to be cleansed and his spirit renewed. See, he's fearful that his sin will cause God to take the anointing of the Holy Spirit from him. And David had seen that, seen the Lord take that anointing away from King Saul with Saul's sin in 1 Samuel 15. And the result is that Saul's relationship with God was never the same as God stripped him of his blessings and his kingship. After Saul's sin was revealed, Saul offers a half-hearted confession, but it's more concerned about keeping his own position than it was about humbling himself before the Lord. And from that time forward, we see Saul's life begin to unravel when God took the anointing of the Spirit from Saul. And his heart grows colder and harder, and he tries harder and harder to maintain his position of power. And so David saw this firsthand. He saw God strip Saul of his kingship, and he wants nothing to do that with that. He says, Lord, he asked the Lord in verse 11 not to cast him from his presence and to not take the Holy Spirit from him. He says, restore to me the joy of your salvation and uphold me with a willing spirit. See, David is just prostrating himself before the Lord, before the mercy of God, recognizing that the Lord has to do it, and there's nothing he can do to restore himself. Now, what's interesting is that this sin of David has major consequences for the rest of his life. Life doesn't get easier for David after he confesses. His sin causes major rifts in his family. It affects the future of generations. But even amidst those difficulties, David retains God's favor up until the end of his days. And David continues to recognize the Lord as his rock, as his redeemer, as his fortress, as his deliverer. And in verses 13 to 17, David seems to describe what life could be like again if God would restore him. He says, I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you. He says, and my tongue will sing aloud of your righteousness, and my mouth will declare your praises. David understands that the power of his own testimony in helping others avoid the mistakes that he made, and helping those who have sinned deeply themselves find their way back to God. You know, it's natural for a person who's been forgiven much to really proclaim loudly the Lord's forgiveness and the mercy that they've experienced. We've seen that before. So knowing how much he's been forgiven leads David to declare his praises to God. And though it's the consequences of his sin are great, David will live with those consequences for the rest of his life. The value of coming clean with his sin means that others will benefit from his pain and experience. And then in verse 16 and 17, David affirms that the external religious rituals will not restore him into a right relationship with God. God doesn't attempt to begin his repentance by offering sacrifices and burnt offerings, which ironically is the Lord's argument against Saul. The Lord told Saul, hey, to obey is better than sacrifice. So David talks about what pleases the Lord. He says, the sacrifices of God are a broken heart. A broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. So more than external religious activities, the Lord values inward change. A broken heart for the damage of our sin has caused in our relationship with God and others. And for those who approach God with a humble and contrite heart, his loving and compassionate response will be to embrace them, and he won't turn away from them. So I know that sometimes it's we grow dull in our senses. We go through the motions in the Christian life, whether it be our daily routines or our corporate worship. It's difficult to always feel guilty or to feel broken over our sin, because sometimes, like David, we're either blind to it ourselves or we just grow comfortable and dulled to the Spirit's conviction. So if you're in that position, and I find myself in that position often, there's another psalm from David that I would want you to encourage you to read and use as a prayer. And in Psalm 139, David prays this, and I think it's a great prayer. It says, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. And see if there be any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." It's a great prayer. Lord, please, I can't see everything that's going on. I can't see what you see, so please reveal it to me. I don't want to walk another day. I don't want to live another day in sin against you. So please reveal that to me. So here's the principle for this point. Is that God desires to restore people to a right relationship with himself. That's what he longs to do that. That's for those who repent of their sin. See, intimacy with the Lord is restored when we bring our sin into the light and lay it before God. When we turn away from our sin and we turn back to God, he will heal us. He will restore us. He will cleanse us. And when we fall and we cry out to him, God will lift us up, and much like parents do for their children, they'll wash off the wound, they'll brush off the dirt, they'll remind us, he'll remind us that he loves us, and he'll encourage us to keep moving. Did you know, as we go into our conclusion, did you know that the man known for creating the Nobel Peace Prize was first known to be the inventor of dynamite? Did you guys know that? Probably did. It was through a fluke obituary in which he was mistaken for his brother who passed away that he read that his lasting legacy would be for becoming rich by finding ways to kill more people faster than ever before. That obituary woke up Alfred Nobel, and it encouraged and it inspired him to rewrite his own story so that he might be remembered for something else besides being a merchant of death. And so with his wealth, he established a series of 6 rewards in the area of science and literature that awarded people for fostering peace. And he said this, he says, "Every man ought to have the chance to correct his epitaph in midstream and write a new one." I love that quote because it's the essence of repentance. Turning away from a legacy of death toward a God who wants to give us a new legacy of life and love, hope and peace. So let me encourage you this morning, whether you're online at home or here, to do a heart check, to examine your heart and ask the Lord if there's anything that you're harboring in your heart that would be harmful in any way to him and offensive to him. And if you don't know of anything, I'd encourage you to ask somebody around you, somebody close to you, and say, "Hey, do you see anything in my life that I need to correct?" And if God reveals something, stop right there and acknowledge it to the Lord. Thank him that he's already forgiven you through the work of Christ. He's already cleansed you from your sin. And if you need to, seek forgiveness from others that you've hurt, and then turn away from that sin and walk toward the loving arms of God who delights to forgive you and show you mercy and grace. Let me pray. Father, thank you for this time. Thank you for reminder of your mercy, your loving kindness toward us. Lord, thank you for this example, for the way David responded when he was confronted with his sin, and thank you that his response, his journal, his prayer to you is a model for how we can confess our own sin to you. So, Lord, we pray that you would convict us. Thank you that you give us your Spirit to convict us. And pray that we would keep short accounts with you, that we would confess our sin, and we would be quick to return to you. And thank you for the promise that when we do, that you'll restore us. Thank you that you've already cleansed us, that you've already forgiven us through the work of Christ. Lord, we love you and thank you for these things. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, each week we're going to move into a time of communion, and each week we come to this time of the service to remember that Jesus has already paid the penalty for our sin. And we can be forgiven because Jesus has paid for our sin when he died on the cross. We can be restored to a right relationship with him because he was willing to suffer separation from God. We can have life because he tasted death for us. So when we come to the table, when we come to take this and celebrate this sacrament, we give thanks for the grace of God that has been shown to us that forgives our sin. And we also call upon God's grace to live in a way that's pleasing to him, the way that he's called us to live in holiness. So it's not taking this, it's not take the ritual of taking this every week that gives us forgiveness. It's understanding that we've been given a new heart, that's understanding what Jesus has done for us that makes this such a memorable and a significant thing that we do each week. In 1 Corinthians, so we celebrate this every week. It's for people who are in the family of God. So if you don't have one, there's one at the table, one of the cups. And so let me read the words of institution from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, where Paul writes, "For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" So if you would stand, and together we'll repeat this, kind of our statement of faith, that Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Hallelujah. The gifts of God for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. This is the body and blood of Jesus broken and shed for you.
So we are singing through the Psalms during this series in our response time. And so this morning we're going to sing portions of Psalm 51 together. But while we were preparing the Psalm this week, one thing that kept coming to my mind is this traditional call and response. It's a traditional piece of liturgy wherein the worship leader recites, "Kyrie eleison, Christe eleison, Kyrie eleison." And the congregation repeats that back every time. And that means, "Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy." So this morning, as we sing Psalm 51, we also join in the tradition of saints that have gone before us.
Thank you.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your compassion, blot out my transgressions. Have mercy, O my God. Wash away my iniquity, cleanse me from my sin, Lord. Against you I have sinned and done what is evil. Have mercy, O my God. Do not cast me away, or take your spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation. Have mercy, O my God.
Have mercy on me, O God.
Have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love. According to your compassion, blot out my transgressions. Have mercy, O my God.
This week, leave with this benediction. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Have a great week.